morning, all. It's so good to see everyone who's here. And I have a couple of announcements. First of all, most of you probably already know this. The women's luncheon is today after worship down in the fellowship hall. It's the luncheon honoring women in our church, but men and everyone is invited. So we hope we have a good turnout. Another announcement is property committee meets next Sunday right after worship. And I have blessings to share. Janice Alke has two blessings to share. Jesse Handelider, a member of our church. Is Jesse here today? I don't see him yet. Well, anyway, that's Mrs. Winternheimer's grandson. And he was crowned king of the prom at the high school last night. So when we do see him in church, be sure and bow down to him. Joking. And then Janice also wanted me to mention or to announce that Sage, her granddaughter, Sage Alke, is home from her study abroad. She's been on a ship in the Pacific Ocean going around Africa. I'm not sure where all she's been, but she's been on that ship for 133 days, and she's home safe. That's actually a blessing to share, Janice said. Are there any other blessings to share or announcements that we should mention? Hearing none, let us turn our hearts and minds to worship our Lord.
Thank you. Please stand and join us for our opening hymn, number 530, I've Got Peace Like a River, all verses.
Please pray with me. O God, creator of all that is, we have come this morning to praise you, to show our thanks and appreciation for your love, your grace, mercy, hope, and peace. We will always be aware of this day's numerous gifts. May we live in constant awe and gratitude of you and all you do for us and all you provide for us. We also give thanks for the prayer Jesus taught his disciples as we say this wonderful prayer at this time. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And at this time, if all our children would come forward for our children's moment.
It is so good to see all of you here today. Veda, you have really grown up. Henry, you're growing up too. Well, you guys know that we really care about you, right? That you're loved by this congregation, that you're special people. And you know, I really like candy. Do you like candy? Do you like candy? You know, I love Tootsie Rolls. Do you guys like Tootsie Rolls? Are they good? I really care about you guys. And Tootsie Rolls are really good. Ooh, that's a good one. I don't like them when they're really soft. I like them when they're a little bit gooey. But I really like Tootsie Rolls. Did you guys say you like Tootsie Rolls too? But you know, I really care about you. But when I say I care about you and I'm eating a Tootsie Roll in front of you, does that mean I really care about you? What does that mean? Can I say I care about you but not really care about you? Yeah, Veda, that's really, really good. You know, Jesus says we're supposed to love others as ourselves. But if I eat a Tootsie Roll in front of you, is that loving you? No, it's not loving you. It's not enough just to say we care about you or love you when we don't help you or share with you. Sharing is what? Love? So you know what? What do you think? Should, if I really care about you, I'd give you a piece of candy, right? Come here, Veda. Can you say that in the microphone?
Share it is candy. Share it is kitchen.
Okay. Caring is caring. Okay. So which is better, to say it or to do it? To do it. Well, we do care about you and we love you a lot, and we want you to remember that caring is not just saying it, it is doing it. It's just like you hear every Wednesday from Miss Stacy, share God's love, right? All right, let's pray. And then as Henry, would you like to say the prayer? Okay, come here. Let's pray. Can you say the prayer? Dear Jesus. Amen. All right. You guys, we care about you, and you can pick out which kind of candy you want. Just one, no. Tootsie Rolls are good. Oh, that's a minty one. You might want a Tootsie Roll. Yeah, that's a peppermint patty. I'll tell you what, once you take one more, two more for your grandparents. All right.
Grandma likes these.
Does she? Take one for Virginia. All right. Thank you, guys.
We have three additions to our prayer concerns this morning. Two in the insert, Sabrina McIntyre Williams, and also a friend of Kim's, our church secretary, Reverend Denver Shelton. And then this just came into our elder chair this morning, Janice. Niall Gay is in the ER this morning. And following the service, I'm going to head on over there and I'll have more information during the dinner. Brothers and sisters, let us place these concerns before Christ at his table. Let us continue our worship.
Mom.
Let us pray. Life-changing God, this morning we have met you here in this place of worship, and your spirit, your presence, calms us. Yet there are also times when you reach out and stir the deepest places within us, inspiring us to dare to do new things and to trust you in new ways. Oh God, this is our upper room, and we celebrate the pure grace you have offered to us in Christ Jesus, the one who lived and died yet broke the bonds of the tomb and offers us new life. Yet we are so aware of the concerns that we lay before you today for those who are struggling to set aside worry and begin to trust in you. For those wrestling with a decision that seems much too unclear, for the ones who need reconciliation with you and those they love, for those who seek to grow deeper in their walk with you and need your wisdom, for this world and the suffering that is all around us, all this chaos that we see, we ask for your presence, that the breakthrough of your kingdom might be known in this time and place. And help us to let go of all those things that you call us to surrender. Teach us to walk with you and work with you as we learn to trust in the unforced rhythms of your grace. And loving God, we are grateful for the gift of new life in Jesus, for the death that freed us, for the love that transforms us, and for the hope that inspires us to continue. We praise your holy name. In your Son's precious name we pray, Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Our stewardship moment this morning, we understand that the Lord calls us to be the stewards of his abundance, the caretakers of all he has entrusted to us. May we always use God's gifts wisely, and may we share them generously. In Hebrews chapter 13, verse 16, we are told, "Don't forget to do good and to share what you have, because God is pleased with these kinds of sacrifices."
Thank you.
Dear Heavenly Father, we bring these offerings to you for our church to continue the good works of sharing the message of Jesus' love. We ask that you bless this offering and guide us in how it should be used. May all we do glorify you always. This we pray in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Make me a channel of your peace. When there is barren lot, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, ever joy. Oh, Master, grant that I may never see. Consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is pardon, let me bring your pardon. In giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to eternal life. Oh, Master, grant that I may never see. So much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to wonder, as to understand, to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your pardoning that we are pardoned, in giving of ourselves that we receive, and in dying that we're born to return.
From John chapter 15, 1 through 17, Jesus said, I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you. Just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Some branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. And this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you, and I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. I am giving you these commands so that you may love one another. This is the word of the Lord. Amen. We continue our reflections on the upper room and its significance for us and all Christ's disciples. In the upper room, Jesus knew that before sundown, that very next day, unless a miracle happened, he would be arrested as an enemy of the state. He would be tortured, killed, and put in a grave. Jesus knew that in the excitement, with the intense emotional feelings of the people, his own disciples would betray, deny, and desert him. His ministry, the work of his entire life, suddenly appeared to be ending in failure. Yet, with all the tragedy facing him, he turned to his disciples and said, "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full." What? Can you imagine a person about to be executed as a criminal talking about joy, happiness, and gladness? Was he delusional? Or did he know something the world does not know? Let's look at this joy that Jesus spoke about that night. If you read through the Gospels, all four Gospels, and look for the joy of Jesus, you will be amazed at what you will find. The Gospels show Jesus to be a joyous person, a fun-loving person who brought gladness and joy to everyone wherever he went. His very presence made people feel better. His greeting, "Be of good cheer, was well known. In John chapter 20, verse 20, says, "Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord." On countless occasions, Jesus was a guest at social gatherings like weddings or a banquet or a celebration with his friends. He was a welcome guest, and he brought joy to every room. We can trace his path throughout the country by the happiness which he left behind. Wherever Jesus went, hearts were healed and diseases were cured and sins were forgiven. Hope came to those who were depressed and people restored to health and cleanness of mind and soul. Jesus wanted people to have joy in their lives. It troubled him to see so little joy in the people. He came to bring joy to them. In fact, he said, "I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." So what was Jesus' secret for joy? Well, first of all, Jesus believed that God was in control of this world and lives in the heart of those who trusted in God's mercy, God's love, and God's grace. While evil hearts and wild emotions were soon to destroy his earthly life, Jesus knew that God was still in control. God would stand by Jesus and bring his soul safely home through the storms of physical life. Believe in God, Jesus told his disciples then, and he tells you and me this morning, believe in God. Believe that you're not alone in an uncaring universe. Believe that you are in the very hands of God, who is goodness and mercy and power. Believe that God is with you, and that with him there is forgiveness of sins, healing for the sorrow, strength for the day, courage for the task, and hope for tomorrow. When we cling to that faith, nothing, not even a cross, can destroy the spirit of joy. Jesus said that our joy would be real and lasting. Earthly joys, well, they're here today and gone tomorrow. What made us happy last week may make us bored and blue today. What we thought would be the ultimate joy can become quickly a nightmare. But Jesus' joy is not as the world gives. It is genuine and grows more beautiful through the years. Joy, heavenly joy, makes life worth the living and our tasks worth bearing. If you think you lack joy, place yourself in the Son of God, that great, joyous Jesus, who brings joy to every room he enters. And may he enter into this room. For in his love and light, your life will grow sweet and mellow. And then, hearts will be touched and filled with joy. Friends, if you want inner joy that puts a song in your heart, hope in your dreams and security into your days, ask Jesus Christ through the Holy Spirit to take control of your life. Let him be your guide. Obey him by living in God's love, seeking to love others as Christ has loved you. And when you do that, you will know the truth of his words. "These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be complete in you." Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Help us in a time of confusion and misunderstandings to hear again the call of Christ and to follow him in faithful obedience. Where vision is faulty, bless us with the gift of sight. Where timidity keeps us walking in familiar circles, give us a hunger for adventure. Where unworthy desires and temptations seek to hold us back, free us, heal us, and empower us anew. O God, give us your heavenly joy. In Christ Jesus' name, amen. Brothers and sisters, prepare your hearts to receive the joy of Christ as you stand and dedicate yourselves once again to following Jesus. As you go to the Lord's table today, may you open up your hearts and reflect on the love that Christ has for you, and that you might have joy. Brothers and sisters, all are invited and all are welcome.
Remembrance. Please join me in prayer. Eternal God, we come to this table as a church family, brothers and sisters in Christ. We thank you for the forgiveness that is ours. We pray that you will remove us from the things that separate us from you and from each other. As we eat this bread and drink this cup, we pray for the power and presence of your Holy Spirit. With a renewed commitment, we promise to go forth from this table to serve you as our Lord and Savior. Amen.
And let us remember, while Jesus was in the upper room meeting with his disciples before his death, he took the loaf, he broke it, blessed it, and gave it to them, saying, "This is my body broken for you. Take and eat." And then he took the Passover cup of blessing, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for the sins of the world. Take and drink." Gracious God, we give you thanks for this meal, this place where we can once again have our hearts filled with joy. Oh God, may we be faithful to our baptismal vows of following you in attitude and actions, and to participate in your ministry that you began in Christ Jesus. Oh God, we love you. May we be faithful. Amen. Veda, would you like to say the prayer before we leave? Okay. Come on up. Okay. Just say it really loud. May Christ be with you. May Christ be with you. Amen. Amen. Let's go. Would you like a piece of candy?